and they are about to enter the Key West Arena right now because it is time for our first game. And when they do walk out, they are going to be greeted by a huge roar. Make some noise, please, for both teams. Seb, how nervous are you on that walk-in?
I'm super nervous because I don't want any of those players to go home. They're not going to go home after that game, but I don't even want them to lose. You know, yeah. They all deserve to win. Like, they're all so talented.
Ben, if you are in that and you're walking in right now, just one of those how nerve-wracking is that walk-in? Is that the worst part of the whole experience? Once you get to the booth, you can kind of get back in your team and start communicating again and almost forget the fact that there's thousands of people watching.
Yeah, I mean, ideally before a game like this, you've just been, you know, playing two or three Dota games in a row, and, you know, before you walk in, you have to see the crowd, the loud music, the lights, the amazing Dota 2 stage that you're actually playing on. Yeah. Everything's just wild.
Yeah, it is crazy out there. We haven't really talked about the stage too much, but and you're not supposed to sort of, you know, point at production and say that that's amazing, but actually it is pretty a special stage. Amazing lighting. We're going to see some stuff throughout this as well. What have you seen so far?
I've seen some.
Because I saw you getting all excited about it.
Some pretty good stuff last night when we were doing the rehearsal. Yeah. Yes, I hope to see a lot of it today. I'm not going to spoil it. I think that would ruin a lot.
We'll leave it for you to enjoy. But as these two teams match up then, Winter, where do you put your money? I'm going to put you on the spot now. This is the hard bit of the show, by the way. This is what we were talking about last night.
Do I go for the stability of LGD or do I go for a bit more random and risky? But you know, and when you talk about risk and you ask yourself at this stage of the event, if stable play is the thing to get you further, or you need to take that a bit of risk, you know.
Yeah.
For me, I feel risk is sometimes necessary to move forward.
Okay. So your prediction is?
Empire.
Okay, confirmed. All right, Wagga?
I was having breakfast actually with Resolution this morning, and he seemed really relaxed and very, you know, he was very talkative and he seemed very, very focused for this game. So I'm going to say 2-1 for Empire on this one, actually.
Okay, so that's interesting.
He swayed my mind.
So Team W have gone for Empire.
Oh, we're covering both no matter what wins.
Okay, brilliant. All right, okay. What about Team M over there in the corner?
Like, I'm the biggest fan of the Empire guys, and if they are going to win TI, this is when they're going to show it. But I have to go with LGD, so I'm going to go 2-1 for LGD, and it breaks my heart.
Wow. That's about the fourth time you've had your heart broken today.
It's broken a lot.
Sorry about that, buddy.
I'll go 2-0 LGD. I think they just look so much stronger than in a group stage.
Okay.
And as you said, I expected Empire to be like the Cloud 9 of Group A, like, you know, third place, solid third place, and Cinder didn't expect them to be first, but where they're at right now, I think LGD's prepared.
Okay, as you can see, we're about 50 seconds away from our first game. So final thoughts on this matchup. You've given your predictions. You've kind of separated into teams here, which is really weird. We didn't practice that, I promise you, on the show. Ben, final predictions on how the match plays out.
I think LGD is going to capitalize on like one or big two team fight mistakes that Empire has. They overextend a little often. They take poor fights occasionally.
Okay, Seb.
The backbone of Empire is going to be Silent. We haven't mentioned him so much. He is a monster under pressure.
Okay. I actually think Yoku. Like, Yoku on Empire is a beast, and I really like his play on any initiators.
Okay. I think the support from Empire would actually get an advantage for their team early on, but it'll be up to the whole team whether they don't make any mistakes after.
Okay, ladies and gents, the countdown has begun. Game one is right here.
LGD Gaming versus Team Empire.
Empire's turn to ban.
That's right, we are in the first draft of the quarterfinals of the upper bracket of the International 2015. LGD Gaming versus Team Empire. And we have four perfect men to take us through the draft. How much argument is going to go on in this draft? I have no idea right now, but it's going to be a lot of fun. Gents, what are you expecting to see?
I think the Bounty Hunter would be a key hero here because Empire will be looking to trade a lot of kills. And yeah, Bounty would give the advantage to that team. And the other hero I feel would be in contention would be Io, because LGD might actually pull out the Io early on in this game.
Seb, you said to me yesterday over dinner, first two picks today in this first match are really, really important.
Yeah, they are very important for both of the teams, and I think they know that. And those teams are very stable, and they pick really close to the meta. You know, the most picked heroes are Gyrocopter, Tusk, Dazzle, those heroes. And those are heroes that are going to be contested by those teams. And they received the first pick Tusk. I don't think anyone is very surprised by that one. Special mention to the SF ban. That was, like, it's a resolution respect ban. Obviously, SF on Radiant is extremely powerful, and Empire used that very well. They like to group up, and grouping up behind an SF that gets mech is always easy.
Oh, they're super good at doing that. Also, one thing to mention in this ban and pick phase so far is that Nagasaren and Bounty Hunter are both still available, and they have been first banned plenty in the group stages. So I think you're onto the right track about Bounty Hunter being super important here, but Nagasaren as well, have to look out for that hero.
I think Dazzle is almost of equal importance, especially against a team like Empire, who are very, very aggressive, just preventing
Queen
some of those kills
of
very
pain.
Early. And how could we forget Queen?
Like a very classic opening for
LGD. I think we had this stat on Queen. For LGD, LGD has not picked Queen so far, and they only ban it and they don't pick it. So, yeah, that's what we see, that they don't. I feel the reason why they don't prioritize the Queen as much is the way they've been playing. Queen of Pain has a very long cooldown ultimate, so you don't get to have the Sonic Wave at every fight. So that could be one of the reasons why they don't prioritize Queen as much as the other teams.
That could be why. I think the Empire are very happy to grab it up though, and along with the Nagasaren, you have a pretty good start for a team fight, so they're kind of securing the team fight already and having pretty solid laning with Queen of Pain already.
Yeah, Empire, they exclusively play Naga support. We haven't seen them run the Naga core yet, so it's most likely a Naga support. And the Dazzle, it was expected. Empire had to expect that. I mean, the Tusk Dazzle opening is like the classic LGD opening, along with the Lina Tusk. Like those three heroes, Lina, Tusk, Dazzle, is. They pick almost exclusively that in the first phase.
This doesn't seem too different from the group stage. And one of the things we have discussed is 10 seconds, maybe people holding some things back, maybe they were playing some pretty standard stuff, no pocket strats, and actually we'd see that come out in the quarterfinals. Not so far.
The most successful team usually, like what they want in the group stage with, they're going to keep on playing it. And turns out the meta of that TI is very close to what Empire has been playing for this like past months in like before that tournament.
Yeah, I think LGD will stick to their guns. Like, it's still working for them. They're going for the Dazzle. They played it before. You get good sustainability. It's, you know, why change it if it's already winning you the group stages?
Yeah, for LGD, we said, yeah, there's no reason for them to change. For Empire, we pretty much discussed that. It was never an issue with their draft. They can pretty much do whatever draft they want, and it's always up to their playstyle, their execution, that will win them the game.
We talk about that. They mainly need to cut down on the mistakes, the overextensions they've been doing a lot in the group stages.
Yeah, can punish you really hard. And second ban phase is pretty important here for both teams. Bot Seeker being banned out by LGD is kind of interesting. The hero has not had a lot of success at TI at all.
I mean,
like 35% win rate?
I feel the teams that have been banning Blood Seeker usually have the Tusk, and Tusk is a hero that you don't want to go into the silence, or the Blood Rite of Blood
That's
Seeker.
True.
Yeah, so that could be probably one of the reasons. And I like the approach of Empire banning out the anti-mage here as well, because Empire have a lineup which revolves around team fighting. So the other way of dealing with team fight, if you're the opponent, you go for split push, and Anti-Mage or Phantom Lance will be really good at dealing with that. So I like the ban a lot. So Empire is like, LGD, we want to take the fight to you. We want to go and group up 5v5 early.
That looks to be the case. I wonder if Empire, with their picks here, is actually going to go for Lina in their second phase. I think it's quite likely. Aloha Dance has played it a lot in the past, but of course LGD might ban it out here.
I think LGD wants it as well, like Seb mentioned before this, like they like to go for their standard core Tusk, Dazzle, plus Lina.
Exactly.
So they have very good lanes, got good bursts, and very good at defending their other teammates with the Dazzle and the Tusk. So that could also be what LGD is looking to go for.
Empire is really the team that can, like, they're going to punish every mistake or every weakness there are in your lanes. And LGD, on the other side, they always have very stable lanes, very strong lanes, very stable pick. Duck Chao 8, it's his signature as a drafter. Yeah. So let's see how Empire reacts to that, because it's not going to be so easy to catch them off guard early on.
Yeah. I mean, LGD has the harder to read draft so far, because Tusk Dazzle, that doesn't give away much at all. Like, you really don't know a lot about what LGD want to do here, apart from what you have seen in previous games. Looking over to Empire, though, Queen and Naga, it really sets the tone for your playstyle in a big way.
I like the Disruptor on towards their lineup as well. Disruptor, Naga, plus Queen. It's a good way of dealing with the Snowball. You can set up with the Song of the Siren as well. So I think it's a solid pick for Empire if they want to go for more team fight.
And it's a hero they play a lot. Like, they play a lot, especially on Aloha Dance.
I'm surprised they didn't ban it. Like, not banning the Disruptor in the second phase after the Naga is really surprising.
I mean, there's so many good teamfight follow-ups to Song, though. There's Darkseer, there's Earthshaker, which we saw ban out, there's Magnus, which I think Empire plays a lot more than most other teams.
You can tell that Empire did their homework, obviously. I mean, LGD must have done it as well. But I mean, the Anti-Mage ban and the Lina ban, those are lineups we've seen run by LGD, like the exact same lineup, like Dusk, Lina, Dazzle, or Dusk, Dazzle into Anti-Mage. They did that a lot already. Remaining.
Definitely.
We haven't seen Viper banned. I think every time that we see...
Yeah, the Queen pick, you ban the Viper. But LGD hasn't been running that too much. That probably also the reason why Empire chose not to just ban the Viper, and they'll go for the Anti-Mage. Spirit.
That's a more. Now they just took the biggest risk, that has been taken
maybe,
so far in that draft.
Yeah, it's a big risk, but maybe is such a good Storm player. He is a monster.
But it's going to be a Storm versus Co-op Radiant, which is a tough matchup for the Storm mid for sure. So let's see how LGD like protects that Storm.
It's the most likely lane anyway, but there's also the possibility of running a safe lane Queen here. A lot of teams have done, but Queen against Storm is a fine lane for Empire.
Yeah. Even for LGD, they have run Storm on the safe lane in the group stages where they put it on Syla. So it's still a possibility that the Storm might not be in the middle lane at all.
And you indeed called it, so they just picked the DK, which is very good for them. It's going to be a Queen safe lane to help dominate the... It's funny, so the approach of Empire is that they don't actually want to look to shut down the Storm too early. They're really going for that team fight oriented lineup you were talking about because they're placing a melee versus the Storm, which is going to give a good lane for the Storm.
I think it's important to note that as a Storm, if you go mid against a DK, Storm wants to roam and do stacks and just whatnot, pressure the opponent's team. But against a Dragonite, whenever you leave the lane, you get punished, you lose the tower. So
you have to stay on your lane versus DK.
Yeah, you have to alter your playstyle against Dragonite.
Yeah, and also later on for Storm, it's not going to be easy fights because there's Naga Song, of course. There's Queen who will build into either an Orchid or a Hex most likely against the Storm. And there's the DK instant stun. So there are some hard spells to play against LGD now. Their next pick is pretty important. Luckily, they do have Grave and Snowball to protect.
Exactly, they needed reliable disables because when you face Storm that has the Snowball backup, the Grave backup, it's quite scary to play against. The Bloodstone into respawn, you know, all those.
I mean, the split push is real now. They have Phantom Lancer and Storm. They're going to be looking to split up the map, try to get pickoffs here and there with the Storm. The Tusk will be mainly, I guess, defending with the shards or getting a pickoff as well. But the early game will be definitely Empire favored, I feel.
So now what's your approach to Empire? Do you go all in, push all in team fights? You're like, all right, we're not going to get into like late game because facing this split push Storm is too risky. Or you actually try to adapt your pick and you try to make sure that, you know, crossing the 30 or 40 minutes mark is not...
I think you go for somewhat all-in play because against a Phantom Lancer and Storm, you don't have anti-mage. That's a big problem. Usually you go for that against Storm, PL. So I feel Empire has to do something drastic. Like they have to take the game in the first 15 minutes. They have to remove the first three tier 1 towers of LGD and control the map from there.
Yeah, as strange as it may sound, I think going all-in is less risky here than the other route.
I completely agree as well. Like, if you just split up this game, Storm is just going to find pickoffs and you won't really be able to bring down Phantom Lancer
with just
a few heroes.
Yeah, it's
going to
be a nightmare for Witch Doctor if the game becomes a split type of map.
Exactly.
Witch Doctor is not going to be able to do anything.
Well, especially if Storm gets better start than the Queen as well, you could easily just take over and kill her alone.
And I like the Sand King ban as well. Like, the Sand King would be a good hero to actually pick off the Storm or PL. And, you know, that's what Empire like to run on the offlane.
What Empire lacks, though, right now, it's those Connery, those
Axe.
Initiating heroes.
Axe maybe? Jokin plays Axe?
Exactly, something like this. It could be Axe, could be Magnus. They just banned the Sand King, they banned the Shaker earlier. That's what they need. I mean, they need it because it's how they play. And right now they don't have that hero that actually goes in. Sure, DK can get a Blink, Co-op can get a Hex, but they don't really have that, you know, AoE initiation or AoE control.
Centaur, do you like Centaur here?
Yeah, Centaur could be a really good hero as well. They need that AoE control, especially versus PL.
Yeah, Centaur could work. It's like Centaur, Axe, or Magnus, as you said. And then, of course, Shaker, Sand King. These are Yoku's heroes, those that he dominate with. So LGD targeted him, tried to ban him out, and now Empire has the choice. Which one do you want?
I think Puck's pretty good, too. I like the Silence versus Dazzle, so you can actually kill people. Focus one person down with Dragonite, focus another down with
Axe.
Puck.
Yeah, I don't know if Puck would have been that good with Queen together. I just feel the two of them in the same team kind of makes it so you have to run around your opponent too much.
You need like a fun lineup. I feel like Axe would fit the lineup much better. So right now they have a lot of bursts. Like Axe is going to jump in. They have like Witch Doctor, Ultimate, and Queen. So Axe would have a much better. And it's also a counter towards Dazzle with talk about it a lot.
Definitely.
Like, teams have been underusing Axe against Dazzle in particular during the group stages.
Axe was the go-to pick for sure. In that situation, it's also quite tanky. It's going to help them with the sustain and the push.
Do you actually think they would actually dole in Axe plus Witch Doctor and just leave? I mean, they could do it to pressure the PL. You don't want the PL to just snowball and keep farming. So Axe, Witch Doctor, Naga would be maybe just freestyle, do whatever she wants, just running around here and there, controlling runes, maybe stacking, helping the... I don't think the Queen needs that much help from the Naga, so the Naga is really free to do whatever she wants to do in the game.
That's the power about the Safe Lane Queen, is that you have that freedom. So definitely, they could get a good start on Axe, and that's super crucial.
I also see the fact that here Dazzle is quite a strong lane. This is a lane that is almost impossible to contest, honestly. This PL Coral Dazzle is almost impossible to contest. I don't think they should invest too much into trying to shut it down because it's not going to happen.
LGD is like not going to five man. They're going to just split right now against Empire. Empire are the team that wants to five man and take the towers.
Yeah, but at the same time, LGD dangerous pickoffs. Strong strength.
I mean, Keeper of Light is so crucial though. Without Keeper, they have no wave clear. I mean, Frost Shards maybe, but. I mean, all it takes is one pickoff on them.
It's such a great last pick from LGD. Like, we saw it coming, sort of, because they were, you know, like, showing the speed push with Storm and PL, but that's a very good last pick.
All right, thank you very much, gentlemen. It is time for our first game of the knockout stages and brackets of the International 2015. It's time to go over to our commentators, Sindarin and Toby Wan.
Thank you very much. Let's get TI5 underway. The first game here on the main stage. I'm honored to be sitting next to Sindarin here. What a fantastic game to start with. LGD, the top of their group, Team Empire. It would be their dream. They've been cursed to TI so far. Can they break it?
Well, they've definitely been looking better this TI than previous years, at least a lot of their players. So going into the tournament, I think Merlini overstated it a little bit, saying that I was expecting them to be first in their group, but I had high hopes for them for sure. And just like Mad said, this is the time when they need to prove their worth, right? If they can win this matchup against LGD and get to the winners bracket semifinals, they will definitely be one to look out for to go the whole way in this tournament. So on the other side, LGD, obviously, we have the storylines coming in with Xiaowei, champion from last year and exceptional captain, looking to do it again. This is going to be one hell of a matchup, and I love the draft, too.
Well, it's such a great combo. Like, we were looking for this from Team Empire. It's that ability to have the strong team fight with a blend of initiation and let them do what Resolution was saying during his interview. They want to be at a team fight. They believe it's their biggest strength, and they've drafted towards it. 30
seconds to back. They're going to try, as it looks with their lanes right now, to do something a little unusual for Empire, playing the offlane Queen of Pain for now for Silent, but it could just be flat out an aggressive trial lane and look to safe lane with the Axe against, well, what matchup could he expect? Probably a one-on-one against Tusk, which is pretty good for Axe. Even any dual lane they can put with Tusk, Axe should have a pretty good time against with eight tangos in the south. So, yeah, laning stage is starting to shape up now. No one's going to contest runes, so the mid laners for either side will take that.
Stupendous. Safety at the start of the games. With this lane, though, now you're running a Queen of Pain on the off lane. Do we have to look to keep Aloha Dance up there with the Naga Siren and always want to fly? Do they have to babysit Silent, or should they be down there creating more space for the Axe?
I think this is a really good call, because no matter which dual lane LGD puts up top, I think the PL will be under a lot of pressure, so they kind of have to do a 3v3 in the top lane, which is what they want, because then Axe gets a one-on-one against the Tusk, which he should win, or at least do very... Nah, he should win that for sure. And even should LGD try lane safe lane, I still think Empire's lane is actually good enough to challenge them here.
Yeah. Easy control at the very, very start. He did the sharp block on the side trees, and this just made it so difficult for Yoku to get in close up against both Yao as well as Zhao Wei. But it's going to be also a lot more fun on this top lane for Sila. This PL, while he might have escape mechanisms, Aloha Dance is not going to give him any space up against Silent, and it looks like we've already seen the first rotation of the game. Always want to fly, they're bringing him down to bot, obviously because of the presence coming in here from the Keeper of the Light.
This is a little bit early in my opinion. I don't think they needed to do it just yet. The pole is blocked, which they probably didn't know, so always want to fly is probably going to be a little bit annoyed with that, but Yoku is still doing all right. Like, the kill potential of LGD's lane doesn't come much into play unless Yoku is like very low health or the Tusk is level 6. He should not be able to die. They're putting on a lot of good pressure here, though, but... Yeah, as mentioned, plenty of region on him.
It's shard spam as well as Illuminate. They're trying to hit Yoku the entire time, force him under the tower. His last hits aren't that bad, like it's 5-for-2 on this lane, but now always when a fly is also going to start to take the punishment here, and they can easily move a lot faster onto that Witch Doctor. Keep in mind their snowball's there, but Coddle isn't the greatest combo with him.
They're spamming very hard in this bottom lane, and now they have to take a little bit of a break, because Xiaowei is running out of mana. He's going to chakra himself now, and he has his last clarity running. Yao's got his running as well, looking for the 2-minute rune. So this is going to be a little bit of a safe time here for Yoku in that bottom lane. Meanwhile, top lane, looks like the plan to shut down PL is working decently well for Empire so far. He's got 4 CS against the 9 for 2 on Silence Queen of Pain. Meanwhile, in the mid lane, though, Storm, as he should, is beating Dragon Knight, maybe a little bit more than expected, though. Resolution generally very good at his Dragon Knight mids. He is quite far behind already against me.
Yeah, a lot of DKs have had success during this tournament just because of this high-breed fire spam you can get out from him. But even with the bottle that's now being couriered out to him, with an extra stick charge, looks like he's just feeling a little bit low on the mana.
Okay, I may have spoken too soon. There was another creep wave for Resolution, so they're actually pretty even. He's only 2 behind. I thought they were even on waves, so yeah, pretty even mid lane after all. And as far as the laning stage goes overall, it is just a very even game now. Now, the question is, when it comes to the bigger, like, overarching strategy, who's getting the bigger benefit out of the way the lanes are going right now? I would say slight lead for Empire. They will probably get a pretty fast Blink Dagger on Axe this way, and as long as PL isn't getting a lot of farm, they have the tools to deal with him for quite a long time into the game.
But all this farm that they're getting, like, you got to take this and just turn it into an objective. What's the objective Empire's looking for? Are they looking to kill Storm Spirit, who's really getting up in Resolution's face? There's no level 6, so there's no ball lightning jump behind the tower, so he should be okay, Resolution. But he's having to bring more consumables out. That bottle is flying in again, but Maybe knows he's got Resolution on the ropes.
This is something we've seen from Maybe a lot this tournament. He plays very
bottom lane, paralyzing cast. They're going to go on Xiaowei, Yoku. This could be the opening, the snowball protecting him, but they get a first blood in for Team Empire. Always want to fly the man to spill it. They waited for LGD to be slightly isolated, the paralyzing cast doing the work.
And interestingly here, Empire Yoku is choosing to go for 2 points in Battle Hunger and 1 in Helix, so no points at all in Berserker's Call just yet, but with a cask like that, you don't need it.
No, it's the movement speed, it's the chase after. But Xiaowei returns to the lane. Now they go for the shots, but always want to fly, being pushed out of the icy wall.
And now he gets a point in Berserker's Call, so I think it's very important for him to at least have 1 point so that when the snowball rolls in, they have a counterplay. In case they, well, regardless of whether they roll on him or always want to fly, he wants to be able to disrupt that.
And Yao's having some real issues up against Yoku. If he's able to zone out the Tusker like this and go be looking for first blood, yes, it went to the support, but that Blink Dagger timing compared to when Tusker becomes effective, we're going to see a bigger space.
Notice also that Yoku has gone for an Orb of Venom, which is very unusual on Axis. I think this might be the first time I've seen it. Very uncommon build, but if you're getting a lot up in the face of the opponent, who do, of course, play a melee core down here, it could be pretty nice.
Top lane, Silent, moving in behind the tower. I don't know if he's looking to go with Always Want to Fly here, but he's very aggressive up in the face of Silas. Let's have a scream. Okay, he's going to back himself up. Didn't look like he's going to do anything. He doesn't have it's level 2 scream. There's no burst damage from Silent.
Still doing well as far as farm goes, though, up there. 26 against the 19 of PL, which I think LGD are also okay with, because they should have a feeling that Maybe is doing very well in mid and that he could at any point suddenly just rotate top and give them a kill on at least the Naga. Maybe the Queen of Pain, if she goes for an aggressive blink, they can punish it.
So the work is to get him low so they can't go in?
Yeah, if they can harass them down, that is obviously the best thing they can do, I guess, but at the same time, looking over LGD's lineup right now, what they want more than anything is just to try to find a setup for the Storm to gank whenever there is a possibility. He has the TP scroll already on Maybe in the mid lane, so does Resolution on Dragon Knight, but he's a little more limited when it comes to initiation.
And okay, so Axe with his Orb of Venom, do you actually want to see him go directly into the Blink Dagger? Or are we looking to get a little bit more tankability for him before the initiation arrives for Yoku?
I think this is the type of game where you might have to stop for either a Vanguard or, if he wants, at the very least, Tranquils, which he's buying right now, because he has to be able to sustain against this constant Luminate spam. They can't rely on using the Voodoo Restoration from Witch Doctor the whole time, because he runs out of mana and then they can't make an aggressive play.
The snowball going in the bottom lane, always on a fly, he's the man exposed. And they do find a revenge kill here, LGD moving with Maybe to find that kill. But Yoku, he's not happy back here, but at the same time, maybe he's burned through enough of his mana. He's got a regeneration rune. He'll just go again.
Yeah, it's true. They could just try to dive him. They
they would have noticed that Resolution trying to TP and then he cancelled it, so Dragon Knight cannot help out Yoka right now.
Here comes your TP support as Wish Doctor coming back, but already actually cancelling the TP after Axe dies in the trees behind his tier 1 tower. But this is the punishment you look for. You've gone down a bottom lane, you pick up two kills, but Resolution's dropped this tower down to 1/3, and maybe has a crack over on Resolution. He's got more jumps, but Resolution in that dragon form is a very scary hero.
He's simply too tanky right now. He maybe probably also checked Resolution and saw he had 11 1 charges. So first of all, that of course makes it harder for him to kill him. But it also means Resolution has the potential to just turn it around on him with the stun as well as breathe fire. So he's playing it safe. As far as those rotations, this is what I was looking for LGD, for maybe to get involved in one of the side lanes. And with two kills in the bottom lane, as well as two canceled TPs for Empire, this is a pretty big play coming out for LGD. They're evening out the gold right now, which Empire was starting to build a decent advantage in the laning stage, but it's gone already.
Yeah, it actually is exactly zero. They had just over 1,000 gold advantage in the early stages. The experience that was still like leaning the way of LGD. But we know the power of Empire is going to be when Silent finds these higher levels. You get that burst damage with the Sonic Wave, and you also get Axe with a Blink Dagger. Resolution, he's also one of those nice aggressive players. We saw Blink Daggers being successful on DK, but Shadow Blade options initiating. Maybe Storm Spirit won't see it coming, and then Empire will find their openings.
You know, that's the main difference, though, right? Is that Storm can just be aggressive right now, whereas the Dragon Knight is more item dependent before he can start making that type of plays. Now, as you mentioned, he got 2/3 of the tower mid, so with the next Dragon form, I imagine we will see him being successful there, unless LGD prevents it by, I guess, a good defensive TP or just putting a lot of pressure on Resolution so he has to go back to base, which I don't see happening right now with their heroes.
Is the Keeper like enough if he comes in there? You might be able to mop up the creep wave, but bringing down that tower, that's a little bit more difficult. Looks like bottom lane too, we got ourselves a bit of a rotation. Maybe a Niao are going on a bit of a hunt. They still don't have Walrus Punch. He's only 40 experience points away, Yao, from hitting that Walrus Punch, and they're not finding anyone in the jungle. It's like they're expecting the stacks to be farmed up, but everyone's showing themselves in lane from Empire.
It's also a little bit of a peculiar smoke timing. Tusk is like one creep away from level 6, which makes this gank a lot easier. If they try Resolution, I think they're going to regret it. I simply don't think they have the damage without level 6 on Tusk, and they will decide against it. Head down, maybe find something bottom here, but like you said, the first part of the smoke didn't work, and it's going to be kind of obvious now with
Zhao Wei. He's in real trouble here. The Observer Ward saw him come up, so they'll go for the quick pick off here on Zhao Wei. Storm going to jump in as well, always want to fly. Trouble, not enough life to survive this initiation from maybe, and then they go down to Yoku as Yao jumps in, but Resolution, Dragon Form's already here to defend. Yao dropping low, Yoku just so tanky to breathe fire from Resolution, pushing back LGD. Maybe he's still got 10-1 charges, the Storm Spirit will survive, but the Dazzle, the Shallow Grave may allow him to get back out. The Ensnare, a low art dance controls him. MMY down for the count. The Culling Blade does the work, and that's where Axe is perfect up against a Dazzle.
And everyone being involved in that bottom lane, apart from Phantom Lancer and the Queen of Pain. So still, those two heroes without any kills or assists. But now Silent knows that there's no backup for Salar, and he can try to go for an aggressive play here. I still don't think he has the damage by only being level 6, and Salar's probably going to pressure him more than vice versa. And 9-1's also available on Silo. You're going to see him just run into Silent here. Force out a Blink, most likely. There we go.
Yeah, and Silent will just back up. He wants to drop him as low as he possibly can. However, having PL Illusions replicate on him underneath the tower is not the happiest time in the world. But Yoku, he's got to be the happiest Axe in the world. 1,700 gold, getting closer and closer towards this Blink Dagger, and then he can start rotating on the Storm Spirit. But maybe he's also having a great time. 4,100 in the net worth for him. He's got a lot of mana to work around with here.
It's still important to keep in mind that with the kill score pretty much evening out, the additional tower pressure Empire have made.
Bottom lane, they're coming down, paralyzing Karns because the initial stun. They go into the call, just controlling Yao. He'll be able to get the snowball off. Actually, no, he can't. Down for the count. Maybe he's going to jump in, dragging back Yoku. They're not close enough for the heal bomb and always want to fly. The Voodoo Restoration is doing some work. At the same time, Naga is about to loop in behind LGD to pick up the stragglers. Ensnare and Riptide's available. A low art dance, he goes after Zhao Wei, but a low art dance is isolated. They come on with the heal bomb. It's the PL Illusion doing some work. Zhao Wei, he can't TP out, Resolution's behind him. They're looking for more as we split the fight up. The last attack from the Dragon Knight will find that kill as Yoku, Team Empire, they're walking over LGD on the bottom lane. Silas in trouble, the breathe fire hitting Yao and the Song of the Siren. Aloha dance of 58 life. They're regenerating up. There's no paralyzing cast, but they've got to stun Yao almost instantly. The call with the fire. worth it. Dazzle will find the kill, and we go 8-5 here in our first game of TI5.
That was still such a major win for Empire. I think even after the buyback, they come out something... What were this? Was that 4-2, I think, and a buyback?
It gave him a 3K advantage as far as net worth goes overall. It did dip back down again with the death of the DK, but definitely the advantage does go the way of Team Empire.
They have really made the axe work so far, and now that he has the Blink Daggerman at 12, they could look to make way more of this type of play. It looks like LGD will try to get the bottom tier 1, and should they succeed, that is at least some sort of a comforting play for them, at least considering how much they lost there and they had to buy back the Storm. I wouldn't agree that the Storm's buyback was worth it just to kill the Dragon Knight, but with the amount of pressure they ended up being able to put here in the bot lane, it was probably well worth it. Yeah. And they will be getting it here for Siler. There is no glyph. It's pretty important for LGD. He gets it, and he does. That's 1,200 gold in the bank.
Team Empire have also got a little bit scared. When Song of the Sirens down, you don't have that big controller to allow your team to reset. Is that one of those things we should be looking for as well from Team Empire? Whenever Song of the Sirens up, they fight, and when it's down, they farm?
Yeah, but at the same time, I don't think they need the song right now. I think that's something we'll be looking at, say, 10 minutes later into the game, that the song will be absolutely crucial. It was great for the last fight, don't get me wrong, it definitely did make a difference, but they were already winning the fight without it, so. I would say definitely for now, try to smoke up, get some aggressive plays out with the Blink Dagger on X, get one or two towers with Dragon Form, and then try to control the map and limit PL's impact on it.
Team Empire just saw that Sentry Ward going down. Their Observer's about to time out in the mid lane anyway. And by the time LGD get there, it will be dead. But they're gonna start losing a little bit of vision there. What's happening on bottom? MMY? Very aggressive warding, so they're actually noticing the rotations here of Yoku, and Siler's taking over a little bit of the Radiant jungle. While Siler's got his burst damage, like he finally got that 1-2-4-1 combo.
Yeah, he did show off the Sonic Wave earlier in the bottom lane, of course, so has been used. He's been part of 2 kills, 1 kill, 1 assist, but one thing we forgot to mention is even though the smoke from the Tusk didn't work out towards when they were looking in the Radiant jungle, they still got the good aggressive ward out that's giving them a lot of information about Empire's movements around the mid-tier 1 tower. And if there's one thing LGD wants to do in this game, it's just slow the game down. So these aggressive wards, as they would seem, are actually, in a way, they're defensive wards, because they're out here to scout smokes. That's what they want to know.
Yeah.
Are Empire going for us? Because they will be able to push out the waves very easily with Keeper of the Light, with Ice Shards, with the PL, even the Storm Spirit with his Static Remnants. So they're not so worried about suddenly getting caught off guard, they're worried about the smokes.
Yeah. Well, right now, Team Empire, they're not even going to smoke. It's just going to be a 5-man move towards the top lane. There is a fresh Blink Dagger over on Resolution, so this Dragon Knight can be looking for a quick jump. Maybe he's the only man currently in position behind the tower, and Silent going directly up after him, screaming into the tree line. With the Resolution Dragon Form up, this Tier 1 tower is not going to survive much longer. There's Fortification to delay them, but it looks like LGD, also another defensive Observer Ward being placed down. They realize it's just not worth the squeeze.
They do have Keeper of the Light level 6 now, so Recall is available. Looks like it's going to port to the top lane. Storm, as well as Dazzle, putting pressure in mid, but they will be stopped right now by Loadan, who could actually use the Song of the Siren if he wants to try to set up for it. They're all rotating in from above.
They need to control them. Storm Spirit, is there a way out here? Resolution blinks forward, look for that stun over on Maybe. At the start of this one, they get it too. And the Sonic Wave! Maybe just explodes. MMY is snared up, but that Shallow Grave does not save you from Axe. Yoku on the chase, Blink Dagger, 3 seconds away, but Siler just blinks himself down. Yao and Siler, they get the stun over on that PL. He does have Doppelganger, and he'll jump. There's 3 of them. Which one's the real one? They call all the wrong ones. Siler's gone west, and the Blink up. They'll still be able to find it, but there's no control over on this PL until Battle Hunger will arrive. Resolution, there's your Blink up into the Dragon Tower. Snowball will protect him for a moment. The spin hitting Siler, and Rohalo Hardes in from the side with the Riptide. Always want to fly. He's on one alive, and that PL will bring him down, but Xiaowei is stand up. Resolution wants to keep going. Yoku helping him out, and they're right on the back of Yao. LGD, they're being pressured by the Russians. Yao still ticking down that Shadow Strike and Battle Hunger. They're trying to keep him up. The shards can't control Yoku, but he's going to snowball into Sun, bringing him up. They can't get him up on the high ground. Not just up there, but Yao's at least able to survive. Storm Spirit back into the mix. Silent, blink to the tree lines, finds a second Oblivion Staff. He doesn't know. The Storm Spirit jumps down, chasing after Aloha Dance, but the bigger man, Siler, might be able to escape from this.
He's definitely going to get away. He has another blink in a second and maybe doesn't have enough mana for this, but Empire are playing hyper-aggressively like we would expect in this game against LGD, and they're taking so much advantage of having the two tanky frontliners in both Dragon Knight and Axe, and having the Witch Doctor heal for the backline. I really like how Always Wanted Flying this game is prioritizing it over getting any points in Maledict. I think the heal has played a very major role in their ability to extend the fights for this long. And ultimately, of course, they do end up giving one back away of LGD with maybe respawning, but another big win.
LGD, they're going to try and force an issue. They weave to start with, so the prepared armor to allow them to come underneath this tier 1 tower. Right now, Resolution just triggers DD rune in that dragon form bottom lane, forcing the tier 1 tower. They'll slow down LGD Team Empire with that fortification. There's no Song of the Siren currently up. It's down for just under a minute now. So LGD, once again, should be able to take another tier 1 tower straight after the fight. Little chip damage on bottom, but still an even trade. Or a good trade for LGD.
It seems like that's the pattern of these fights. Empire plays super aggressively, they get many kills, they ultimately overextend a little bit and get caught and lose one, and then LGD take a tower. They've done it bottom, they've done it mid. At the same time, though, Empire have also claimed two towers, so it's pretty even on that account. And The question or the challenge now, as Empire are definitely in the lead of this game, is how do they keep the pressure on the Phantom Lancer? They need to be able to get some aggressive wards out so they see his farming patterns and are able to isolate him and bring him down. And we do, of course, have the Orchid on Queen of Pain, which is really, really good against PL at this point in time. He does not have the Manta style, and it might force him into going Manta over Diffusal, perhaps. No, he could still just Diffusal it. I guess he would go Diffusal in either case. That seems to be the build these days, is either, I guess, optional Drum into Diffusal, and then a lot of PLs actually have not gone for Manta. They've chosen Scotty over it. I guess we'll see what Salazar D is here, but Diffusal multipurpose here, of course, being able to purge that off.
Aloha Dance revealed himself for the moment. Zhao Wei does not want to walk up that hill, but the perfect Observer Ward in the mid lane is letting Team Empire see that Syla is walking directly towards him. Now they go the other direction. They catch out Zhao Wei instead. And now was the smoke gang moving up there, and they trigger the drums. They're just trying to get out of here. They want to get out scot-free. Syla chasing him down. You still have the Song of the Sirens, and as maybe jumps in, it'll have to be used by Aloha Dance for Syla, and maybe perfectly on top. And no, Syla, he threw the ulti out. It didn't affect MMY. They start the defensive weave, Sun will blink away. The rest of Team Empire try to TP out. Actually, just walks back. There's no Team 1 tower protection. Always want to fly, needs to cast, but in comes the snowball. Syla and maybe being controlled. The blink did work, at least for Queen of Pain. Unfortunately, Witch Doctor does not possess the same ability. He will be dying on this bottom lane. He'll make him work for it, but LGD will get at least a return kill.
Yeah, that was a bit unfortunate for Empire. They had a good cask, and then I think the song usage from Aloha Dance there makes sense. Unfortunately, the cask was bouncing at the same time, so that goes to waste. Then, above the fight, Silent has isolated a target and he wants to Sonic, and whoever's target was, I can't remember, actually runs into the song to get invulnerable. Very nice play there, staying alive. And
that was the dazzle.
LGD get a good overall, just, was that a one-for-one trade, I think?
Yes. Yeah,
almost no change.
That's the one. That was a cuddle for a Witch Doctor only. Yes. But you did again blow the Song of the Siren.
Yes.
And Team Empire only seem to be moving into these aggressive positions when the song is up, when they have that get out of jail free card.
So this one's another 2 minutes of farming time for PL, sitting on 2k gold. It's still top three net worth as far as, the overall net worth in the game. We have top three on Empire, but they're not very far ahead of Siler, who will now overtake the X for a bit.
It's staying close.
Yeah, it's a pretty even game. Like, as mentioned, it's a 5k lead for Empire, but one bad team fight and LGD's game plan will just seem stronger. So Empire's under a lot of pressure to keep performing like this.
I still wonder though, like, should Team Empire be looking for these pickups? You get an Orchid over on Queen of Pain, you got a Blink Dagger on Resolution, just finding one or two here and there, that's why they jump up, and again, Zhao Wei, the captain of LGD, has to run, but Resolution caught in the tree line, trying to fight his way out of here, but he's locked and being mana leaked in, and Silent, well, he has to come and help. Zhao Wei, no TP scroll, so he's forced to stand here, while the snowball coming in, Silent will blink up and away from the snowball, Tusker, catching him out in the tree line, while further down, the Witch Doctor goes to work, they bring down that PL. That's one way to stop his farm. The T1 tower, one attack from Resolution will take it out, but instead he wants the kills. The blink forward, they look for that call, the double one as well. Yao is so low, and there's your dunk coming in from Yoku. They need to protect Resolution though. He's so low, and the paralyzing cast plus restoration doing his work. There's another blink in 1 second, but the Sonic Wave, that will take out MMY. A 4-0 trade-off, including a T1 tower, and now damage to the tier 2.
This is not just damage, this tower is definitely gone. Resolution, finally now, his double damage rune expires, but this tower is not long for life. They have no way of holding it. They're responding in 5 seconds, and then the tower is pretty much gone, so
big fight. What's going wrong with the fights, Sin? What's going wrong with the fights for LGD? How is Empire getting the upper hand every time?
It's just difficult for LGD to find the key targets they want to kill. They can't really go on the Naga. She has good positioning, and in this case doesn't have Song of the Siren, but Loadan's played it pretty well in the backline. Witch Doctor Heal is doing so much work, as mentioned before, and who else are you going to go on? The Axe you probably can't kill, the Dragonite you probably can't kill, and then there's a Queen of Pain who has Blink. And if the Storm Spirit jumps on the Quap, if she's fast, she can Orchid him in turn and try to just turn the fight around. It is just very difficult for LGD's lineup right now to fight, and Empire are doing exactly what they need to do. They're forcing LGD to fight.
Orchid, Silent chasing after maybe. No Sonic Wave, so he's just chipping him away and forcing the Storm Spirit to Ball Lightning TP away to safety.
It's just scare tactics. Like, there was no risk of him dying there, but they don't have vision, so he doesn't know what he's up against. And
they're coming for that now. Silent. Always want to fly, taking care of that. But the Observer Ward, there's still that one in the mid lane, which is going to time out in about 13 seconds, but they plan a new one over in the Dire Jungle. So they're really trying to keep tabs on LGD when they can. And there's that Diffusal Blade timing now for LGD. 23 minutes. It's not bad, but really, what's this Diffusal Blade going to give?
It means that if they get ahead in the fight, they have another way now of chasing down heroes and shutting them down. And, of course, some of the key targets on the Radiant side, such as the Axe, is very monitored.
Silent jumping in, Orchid over on Yao. Resolution's right behind him, however, but he'll let him go. There's no Sonic Wave. Or five, but again, that Voodoo Restoration level 5 brings Empire almost back up to full life. And the Shans, well, it's a little bit more chip damage. But LGD is slowly going to lose this tier 2 tower, and they're not finding any space.
PL needs to send these solutions on the Axe, in my opinion, and get his mana drain so he can't keep on. He's going to do exactly that with one of them here.
They didn't last long enough to really do any kind of work. Like, he dropped a little bit of mana. But the Blink Call is still available here for Yoku.
Empire still needs to be careful here. If they lose too much mana on key heroes, LGD can suddenly find themselves in a very good position and try to chase down kills. So it's very important to Loadan's place back. He does it very well. Claim the tower and get out. They don't overextend. I think some teams there could have even tried for the high ground, but it's not time yet. Get the top tier 2, get another core item. Probably looking at the BKB for Silent, which is almost up, and the Axe's Shiva's Guard is only 600 away, so two very big items coming in Empire's waivers.
And LGD's teamfight is getting harder and harder. With no ability to control the DK, and now Axe becoming so tanky and also controlling all of these melee walkers, it's going to be difficult to escape. Then you've got such AoE control plus AoE damage. Team Empire said they like. Teamfight is their strength, and they've hit the nail perfectly on the head in this game, gaining so much momentum. It's actually 11,000 net worth advantage going the way of Team Empire, and the experience is even 7.5k. This is the dream start for Team Empire.
Definitely is now. If they keep their play up, this game should most likely be in the bag. But once again, one mistake. If they get team wipe, or if they just lose, say, they take a couple of fights where they trade, say, 3-for-1 or 3-for-2, just as long as it's LGD favored, they're playing into the Phantom Lancer game plan with Storm. LGD are very good at split pushing, so we're starting to reach the point now when Keeper of the Light can just port the Storm and the PL around and push out the lanes, and if Empire needs to start playing reactively instead of aggressively, all of a sudden they could just run out of time.
Does that mean that Team Empire should be looking to force the issue? Like, there's only one tier 2 tower left. It looks like they're grouping up for this one as well. What is the high ground objective? What do they need to get up?
I think their power is peaking right now. They just got a BKB on Quap, a Shiva's on Axe, 25 minutes in. Their lineup has proven that it's way stronger than LGD's at teamfights, so I would say it's worth considering high ground now. I don't know if any one of their heroes is building a pipe, as we do have a mech on Naga, because pipe would obviously be incredible against both the Keeper of the Light and the Ice Shards from Tusk.
No pipe, just the Assault Cuirass by looks a bit for resolution. Yeah.
And they might just think they could do it anyway, because they can negate a lot of that AoE damage with Voodoo Restoration and just try to slow siege with Dragon Knight. And should LGD try to go for the jump, they will have the Naga back up.
Resolution blinking forward. Ooh. He's not in range of Xiao, right? There's their aggressive Observer Ward inside the jungle that we're seeing, but LGD also have their defensive wards.
They're pretty far away from trading, though. LGD's bottom lane still needs a good 30 seconds to reach the T2 tower, so...
Yep.
Empire will be able to claim this tower for free, I do believe.
Yeah.
LGD are just not interested anymore. And honestly, I think this maybe should have been the strategy for LGD earlier. I think they've just given up too many kills to Empire and should have maybe just conceded towers that they ended up losing anyway.
Team Empire's coming. The Illuminate hits Lohar Dance directly to the face, always on fire. That should trigger the mech fairly early, but you got probably another 10 seconds left of this dragon form. The leads into the tower, he blinks forward, going up to Xiao Wei. The Breathfire even goes up to MMY, and there's
pressure chip forward, and the sonic wave from Silent. LGD is so low, they're being taken out inside their own base. Silent looking forward in the cover of the BKB, but he's not taking too much damage from the tier 4 towers. They went too deep, they have not taken the objective, and now LGD with a buyback by Tuskar, snowballing forward, always want to fly up in the air. Where's that song of the siren? It's not coming yet, there it is. Now Team Empire can back themselves out. There's enough mana for maybe to jump to, and Aloha Dance almost accepting fate here as he lets his teammates jump out. There's no TP scroll on the Naga. He's down for the count. And Team Empire, is that the biggest mistake they've made so far?
Yes, and this is what's dangerous. You could tell how far ahead in the fight Empire felt like they were. They get the dunks of the 5-on-4. Salad comes in from above and hits the 2 Hero Sonic Wave as well as Scream. Orchid's one of them. They're really low under the tier 4s. And then he goes for the dive. Big mistake here where, honestly, his Sonic and Scream should have probably forced both those heroes back to Fountain, or at least forced them to like stand and wait and use bottles or whatnot to get their health back.
And then you take
and
the tier 3.
And they dealt almost no damage to the tower because of this, when they could have just taken their kill, gone for the tower again, reset, re-go. And also the song, this time from Aloha Dance, a little bit too late. They lose an additional hero because he's a little too slow on the trigger.
And because of all of this too, now Silas finding farm. He completes the Yash, but still has another 1,600 gold sitting in his bank account. While he's not part of the top three in the net worth, he is very, very small distance behind all three of them.
And this is where we need to remember the mental aspect of the game, where how do the players assess their strength relative to how far ahead they actually are? Because now Empire might start... They might start getting nervous, right? The push didn't work out, they made a mistake. How much gold did we actually give over to LGD? They obviously cannot see the graphs like we can. If they know they're 12k ahead, they're probably like, okay, we lost a little bit, we could probably
prepare
go again.
Your bodies.
What do they feel like though?
Shall we? He smoked dumps so they don't see him. They'll just see the Illuminate and Resolution as Team Empire searching for LGD. But they feel something on the top lane without fully seeing it, and they just back up. And Team Empire won't find anything. Smart movement from LGD.
Yeah, and immediately they're down to the bottom lane with both Peel and Storm. So if Empire want to make a play top lane, they've got like... They have to do it with the first wave, else they lose a tier 2 bot.
But they keep doing this, like you want to look for a play, but this Observer Ward that's inside the Dire Jungle is seeing all of the movements of Team Empire. Like, they may have their aggressive wards, but it's in the the Dire Observer Ward's always going to scout it out first.
Yeah, this is really good play from LGD. They're just moving them around the map. Maybe is farming the Radiant Jungle. They just pushed out of the bot lane with PL. Okay. And Empire are going to just be like, okay, you know what? If we can't get in top, we could probably go for a Roshan play.
But at the same time, LGD, that Sigil's already moving. It's coming down to have a look. They've got to do this really, really quick on Roshan, but they're only one third through him. And that Sigil's going to arrive when Roshan hits probably just one third of his life.
They do not have Medallion.
They're silent. They're instantly taking it out. He actually blinks up to get rid of it.
They have AC, but no Medallion. And now they might start to get worried. They're getting aggressively woven here by the Dazzle. Keeper of the Light has his ultimate running, so there's Blinding Light to slow them down and to port in heroes here with the recall. And okay, this is the biggest moment of the game right here.
Yeah, they're gonna make the opening and Resolution. He tries to do it, jumps up with that Blink Dagger. He's gonna be isolated from the rest of his team because of the shards, but LGD is so split, the Storm Spirit's still down the Radiant Jungle, waiting for that southern jump in to attack where Empire doesn't have vision because they've got the ward in the high ground on that cliff's top. In fact, they're losing that too. Roshan down to 1,500. The Illumina's gonna hit pretty heavily. That Sigil still doing work. Watch that maybe Storm Spirit jump. Roshan, 700, 600. Song of the Siren is going to isolate it, but Storm Spirit still jumps in. DK is the Aegis to the Immortal. Maybe right in the middle of Team Empire. Stunned up, Shiva's Guard to look great. Doesn't protect again. Empire's got Aegis and a kill. MMY's on the run out of here. They might have got the shards to lock him in, but Star's still doing the work all by himself. Resolution will blink up after him too. So LGD losing the Storm. Luckily though, Bloodstone charge will make his spawn time a lot lower.
Good play there from Aloha Dance to just play it safe with the song. And you know, it's one of those moments of Storm Spirit where you're like, you just jumped in and you're like, oh crap. You get caught in the middle of the song, you know there's an Orchid and an instant stun from Dragonite and the call from Axe. There is no way out. You went for a risky play, you paid the price.
And I'm actually surprised he even jumped. If he had a BKB, that would have been an absolute wonderful time. But the punishment which Empire have done on the map, with a 14k advantage in the gulp now, Empire's just holding on to all the monies. And LGD, they come out again. The smoke from inside their base, this time just with Zhao Wei as well as Yao. Maybe and Sylar still moving out quite visible in the lane. What else we got? We got a Mana Style now done for Sylar.
That's a very big item. It increases his split push potential by a lot because, of course, these Manta illusions last for a long time. Since PL was changed to more of a combat hero rather than the good old split push, more Naga-style hero he used to be, his illusions don't last very long, but the Mantas, of course, have the full duration, and it allows you to really split push with the hero, and he even has Keeper of the Light to back him up for that, so there's definitely enough of that where that came from. It's a secondary way of dealing with the diffuse, with the Orchid, and of course just maximizes his damage output. He very quickly is able to reach his max number of illusions when he uses the Manta as well.
It looks like Team Empire is rallying themselves together to make the most out of this Aegis. Talon's taking care of the middle lane for now, but it's a four-man group up already on bottom. Song of the Sirens off cooldown in 8 seconds time. You are going to get your pipe built on Aloha Dance, that's if they don't finish things now. But
it could also be Glimmer.
It could be Glimmer too, yeah. The Resolution has the full Assault Cuirass. In fact, they're switching it up. So they push bottom lane. Silence got momentum on the mid, and they're just going to go straight up there. Still a little bit more pressure from Always on Apply as he watches the bottom lane. But LGD, they take the T1 tower, with a blink up already from Resolution. They catch out Yao with the Orchid, and you do have that Shallow Grave. They need Yao a little bit lower, so now they can go for the dunk. They also give Team Empire the buff up. Remember, objective-based gaming, they've got to keep going on these buildings and get themselves Rax advantage here against Split Push lineup. But the PL Illusions ripping apart Sal, but number four, we already see Resolution getting in there. Call down, but maybe looking for the kill on Sal. The blink away, not going to be successful, but they're still fighting with the Death Ward. MMY barely surviving back past the Tier 4 towers as Empire, they still try and fight LGD under the tier 3 tower. They've lost two and, well, basically lost most of their mana, especially when you can get that mana drain on Resolution. The extra stun, Sala to the front line, Diffusive Blade Charge being used on Resolution, slowing him down. MMY, do they have enough to really contest Resolution? Remember, he's got the Aegis, the Immortal. Wishdog is back in 23, that's too long. They drag him in, Song of the Siren is still going to trigger Aegis, the Immortal, but maybe the 10 second BKB, that's why he's isolated Resolution. He needs more time and he wasn't bored. Yoki, about jumping back in again, and a Jowl wait to actually bring down the Dragon Knight, and they look for more, maybe jumping deep after Aloha Dance. They keep with the Remnants, they're slowing him down, but there's a very tanky Naga Siren. Vortex back in, now also with the charges, they're gonna bring down the Naga Siren. LGD, Utensin, one fight could change it all for LGD, they just got it.
And again, it's Silent being caught out in the enemy base, going aggressively, and suddenly the Storm Spirit comes out with the BKB and does catch him at the top tier 3. These deaths are so expensive, because the moment LGD get ahead in the fights, they have such a good team to run them down. Ice Shard, Snowball, Sigil,
oh, wait a second, okay. The double claw goes for Yao, the Sonic Wave from Sun, perfectly on target. The PL, however, brought down the Witch on the back lines, but Yoku, he's going on an absolute charge. MMY slow, Silent chasing him down the control, Silent with a call. There is still that burst heal, maybe jumping in, low on mana, but Yoki's got nothing. He's bone dry right now, trying to retreat, but they bring down the axe. Silent has to blink himself away from the PL. While they hit LGD hard, they don't stop the push. The two major cores are still alive. And LGD, they are getting respected. They're gonna back up.
I love the fact that Empire had the confidence to go in 3-on-5 there when they see the good opening for the Axe, but end of the day, they trade 2-for-1 where LGD get the one kill, but it's a 1,000 gold for the PL, ending the beyond godlike streak of the Axe. So I think all in all, this is still a victory for LGD just going for that trade, as Siler is going to be able to get his next big item. He just got the Manta and he has 4,000 gold again.
Yep.
That fight in the base was an absolute huge swing for LGD. And
Where do you even go if you're Silent? You got that much money. What is Empire going to do to you, and how do you stop it from happening?
Axe has to land some calls in the PL now, I think, to be able to control him. It's the Queen of Pain spells. They're not going to cut it anymore now that Siler is going to get a tank item, whether it's a Scotty or a Heart. I imagine he will get one of those two at this point. The Dragon Knight's damage output is not good enough to just splash down the illusions with the Elder Dragon form. And one thing I want to mention, I'm surprised that Empire put the Aegis on Resolution. I think, judging from how the fights have gone so far and what the focus has been, Salad would have probably been a better Aegis carrier, since Dragon Knight is a transformation hero. He comes back without Dragon Form. He is really weak on his second life compared to his first. Queen of Pain, however, good on both lives, has a BKB as well, of course, and would be able to Orchid against. He is going to get jumped here, but maybe pretty slow reaction, though.
Yeah, Queen of Pain.
Still going to be on.
Yeah, it's... There's no control. Like, when you got that side device there, maybe you can have a crack at Queen of Pain, but when you got that side device, you're going to be earlier on the BKB. Now Team Empire, they're going to try and catch LGD out. LGD, they've won a couple of fights, so they might have a little bit more confidence in this game. They'll move up and then realize there's nothing but PL illusions, and to the rest of Team Empire, they're missing on the map. And again, LGD's map awareness, absolutely perfect.
Well, they're noticing they're moving out.
They
just run into them right now.
They could. Yao's actually moving down, and here they come. The jump up, this will be a solid pick off on the Tusker. But they still commit a heavy smoke for it.
Yeah, the problem there, Vampire, there's no collateral. We focus on that a lot. When you get a good gank or a good fight, you want to take towers. And of course, that's what we've seen from LGD a couple of times. They get a little bit of a lead in the fight. They run it down, they get an objective.
Oh, here they come. Oh, okay. Resolution. Very aggressively blinking up into the LGD base. They lose a little bit of the mana here. They need to get rid of these PL illusions as quick as they possibly can. While the tier 3 tower does take a little bit of chip damage, they trigger the mech. Resolution's doing the tank work, keeping that creep wave up. The blinding light forces everyone back. And again, more PL illusions just running in. Siler even able to hold on to this mana style appears, and Team Empire, they just can't maintain the hold in front of the towers.
This is, we're starting to get to the point where, you know, if we get 10 minutes further in and the gold lead is still 10k for Empire, I think LGD's high ground defense is just going to be too hard for them to overcome. They need the next Aegis and they need to go. And I think you're giving this Aegis to the Queen of Pain. You're playing her aggressively like the last fights to force the Storm's hand to go on her or the Tusk and drain a lot of their important cooldowns for your Aegis trade-off and get one or two kills with Axe in the meantime, and then hopefully ride the wave to get a lane of Axe. Because the Dragon Knight, they're not going on him anyway, so why would he have it, right? It doesn't make a difference.
You're right. He'll survive and then the rest of his teammates will be dead, so they just isolate him and kill him off.
Yes.
Just like that chase that happened down in mid lane. Silent moving with his Invis rune. Now he's running down to the bottom lane, looking at Sylar, but this could be the worst kill to try and go for. They jump up, they've got the vision, the sentry wall was there, Sylar's gonna drop. LGD, they were looking for a pickoff and they got it.
And guess who got the kill?
It was the PL, even more money coming in. It's not as though Sylar's got enough of this, but the middle lane's still being pressured. The Riptide coming in from the illusions of Nagasaren, keeping the pressure on and not allowing LGD to force out these side lanes and play this flip push game. They still have to keep eyes on home.
One hero I want to keep my eyes on a bit now is, of course, the Keeper of the Light from Xiaowei, who is starting to build the Aghanim Scepter. In my opinion, one of the best Aghanim Scepters in the game. Permanent ultimate, major heal during daytime, major vision during daytime, which is going to be crucial against Empire's lineup to not get caught out. And when he makes it to that, judging from how the fights go and how Empire kill off their targets, he would be able to get a couple of pretty good Illuminate heals off in those fights. And that could really make a big difference.
At the same time, by the time he's probably got his Aghanim, unless he's able to keep farming up the jungle like he's doing, you should be seeing Witch Doctor with his own Aghanim. He's 2,000 behind. Are they actually moving for this? Empire do not want to go into their own jungle at the moment. And they know it. LGD's missing on every single lane. They got to keep the pressure elsewhere.
It's still worrisome when you're the team that's ahead on gold and you are very cautious with pushing out the lanes right now. This is the situation they never want to find themselves in, where they feel like they need to group up more heroes in order to push. So, oh well, they wanted to group up earlier, but the difference is the pushing speed of LGD is just so high now that if they start showing multiple heroes in the same lane, LGD will push just as fast in another lane and they will gain nothing. Mm-hmm. 1 minute respawn.
And that's actually almost up to the max timer. That's 2.5 out of 3 minutes of the time. What Team Empire would give just to have Roshan up. They take it now and then they move on. Because the rest of the time is this defense nature, allowing LGD to get more lane control. I suppose that would open up a bigger question. You might wait around for Roshan, but like, are you going to waste 2 minutes of the Aegis of the Immortal just trying to get control of the map back again? Because this PL is, at this point, just beating out the Tier 2 tower, but this isn't even the real PL. These are just illusions that are taking up the tower. They Sonic Wave and maybe a Denial, which will be there by Silent. But LGD get what they want. They're slowly and surely taking more map control back from Team Empire.
And they know, by knowing that Silent is top, they can play way more aggressively bottom and try to get into the Radiant Jungle if they want, or at the very least, just control the Roshan pit. Counter ward, and set up for the impending fight. It is going to happen. Empire will be going for this Aegis at some point in time. It's all about being as prepared as possible for LGD.
Looks like Team Empire's going to try and make LGD blind on the map. They're bringing a gem down to Aloha Dance now. Storm Spirit actually jumping in. Where's these BKBs? Resolution gets it off with the perfect call. Yao's down low. They need to bring him down all the way and they cannot do it. The Sonic Wave from Silent. Minimal effectiveness. Yao dropping low to Resolution. He's just sitting up there. Maybe jumps in. They Song of the Siren. It's one-for-one trade-off. They're looking for more. But Team Empire don't want it. Yoku just TPs out in time.
this could be a potential Roshan play for LGD, I think.
With no Song of the Siren against
no it. Song, no Dragon Form. Witch Doctor's out for 30. The trade is Tusk, though, so I guess he would be one of their important Rosh heroes, and they're not going to take the chance here. Will, of course, take them quite a while with Shiloh, but they do have the Solar Crest on Dazzle, so I think between that and a defensive weave, they could try to go for the play. Mm-hmm. They will respect Empire's initiation potential here and play it safe.
Yeah, just back it up. These Naga Illusions are keeping pretty good tabs on the rest of LGD, too.
Sure it is.
So they know what's going on. Resolution in a blink position. The Dire Observer Ward's watching coming and maybe just recalled away.
Keep up the Light Axe.
This is going to get rough for Team Empire.
It's not just about healing the heroes. It's also that whenever you illuminate a wave, not only do you destroy the enemy wave, but you heal your own wave entirely. So there's a lot. It puts a lot more pressure the whole time. And here we go. Siler found a double damage. Fortunate in the moment. They're going to try to go for this Empire, even if they know it's too late. This, in my opinion, puts LGD in the lead of the game.
If they can hold it, Storm Spirit will be the man with the Aegis Immortal. And he's actually got the full sight device as well. So a full sight, the Aegis Immortal, the Aghanim Scepters are up. Yao's got his mech, and how much money has that PL now got? Another 4.9k.
He's got a Firefly, I think.
Either will work. Team Empire is getting into a position like they're just not finding enough damage. Might be another reason too why Resolution's trying to get into this Daedalus, find that splash crit damage if he can get it.
The problem is it's not going to cut it because Siler will be getting a Butterfly and he will be getting crested by the Dazzle. And his evasion is just going to be way too much for the Radiant to deal with. They don't have any MKBs even remotely close at this point. I think Resolution, what he should do here is he should keep his Chrysalis and go for an MKB. It's going to give him better damage output against the PL, who is definitely the hero to counter right now, let's be honest.
Team Empire pinging at the Keeper of the Light. They're actually flagging the fact that it looks like LGD are preparing to fight on bottom lane. So instead of actually moving down there to fight, like Resolution's in the neighborhood, they're just going to move back. Go back to farming up the lanes, try and keep LGD as far back as possible, and make them worry about the trade game. LGD can play the trade game so well, too. All these side lanes just push.
They have an Aegis on Storm who also has a Hex, so I think Maybe's plan in the next fight could be to try to find Aloha Dance and just target him down really fast. Just use his Hex, use a lot of mana to go for that kill, because he knows that if the Naga is down, Empire's disengage strategy is gone, and then all of a sudden they can just run them over once again with the PL.
Yep.
And should it fail, let's say he jumps the Naga and Empire have a great counterplay. To kill this Storm with 13 mana and 2200 health, they need to commit. Probably Berserker's Call, Dragon Knight Stun, most likely the Orchid and Sonic Wave from the Queen of Pain, and then what have you got left for the second life?
Not a lot. And Resolution doesn't even have a second life. He bought the Daedalus, I'm sorry to say, Cinderin. It's not the Monkey King bar. So
makes him stronger against all the other heroes than PL.
Yeah.
But PL is going to be difficult to deal with.
Which basically means Silent and Axe have to take care of Syla.
Yes, and they can't.
Not an easy task. Like, a Blink Call into that much? Like, that would be nice. Storm Spirit, long jump up, maybe the protection of BKB. Gets a Hex on Queen of Pain, then he's Silent dead. But now, well, maybe, can't go any further. Resolution losing a lot of mana here. These PL illusions are just burning him dry again. But LGD, they take the Tier 2 tower, they chip away, don't find an opening, so they don't go any further.
And they can just play the mental game right now. Empire know that this is not going to work out in the long run. So LGD will try to force their hand, but they will not go and push the base because they don't need to.
Mm-hmm.
But rather, I think how much is left on that Aegis? Is it? It's another 2 minutes, so it's possible they will try to take a fight when it's closing in so that they at least get to use it. But until then, they might as well try to get up another key item on one of their heroes here going into that fight.
And Team Empire.
And they also want to fight a day, by the way, which... Right now we're in the middle of the night, Keeper of the Light.
It's kind of like the opposite of whenever we cast a Night Stalker game. But Team Empire, hey, it's just so rough for them. Like, the experience might be sitting at zero, but it's been roughly 30 minutes before there was an advantage. Storm Spirit jumps in Aloha Dance to Glimmer Cape, protecting him and allowing him to run away to safety.
That's ice cold not using Song there, in my opinion. That is so ice cold. Like, the other heroes were catching up. I'm not sure if he's 100% positive there's no gem on the other heroes of LGD. It is Xiaowei who just got it now on the Keeper of the Light in the back lines. But if he gets caught out there, he did not have buyback, and the game would have probably... They would have lost at least a lane of racks on that.
That's true. But having the Song of the Siren is going to make this a lot more difficult for LGD. Storm Spirit jumping in again. This time it's always going to fly the Witch Doctor. But Axe jumping in with a Sonic Wave. The perfect call. The Snowball protecting him to the bitter end. MM1's having the heal up. But they've still lost the Storm Spirit. Now the Tusk going to join him. Empire haven't lost anything. They keep fighting Siren outside the base. But Siren ripping him apart. Siren just cannot repel power like that. He's just not tanky enough. And LGD will keep pushing the issue. Queen of Pain does have buyback. But the Sonic Wave's on cooldown for 15 seconds. He's letting Empire hold the line for now. That Tuskar Snowball almost did all the work for LGD.
It's a good enough hold for Empire, though. Again, Silent, however, he's, I think, out of three or four deaths, he's simply just been over-aggressive, like blinking in very aggressively, gets turned on and isolated, and his team couldn't back him up. I think the Axe wanted to try to blink and help him, but Silent just spreads out his PL illusions. He puts one on Axe and he puts one on Dragonite, and they can't blink out, and it takes them so long to kill the illusions. It's very easy for them to just target down Silent in that position.
So what should Silent be doing, though? Like, he just sits back and roosts the rest of the team? Because right now it almost feels like he's the distraction, he's the bait. It's like, kill the Queen of Pain, I blow everything I've got, I die, and then I buy back. But the rest of the team then has space. Yeah, I know it's looking at the bright side of a bad coin.
But the space was used to kill two PL illusions, so that is not really that valuable, right?
True, not the greatest trade in the world.
He has to play more passively here. He can't play... as a player, he plays super aggressively, and on his Queen of Pain, he is not afraid to fight, which is a great quality to have, but it's just as great a quality to have to know when it's time to go in and how far you can go. And
yep.
He has two super good frontliners in the Axe and Dragonite, so they can easily tank up for him and give him the better position. And then he can try to go for plays like that. But once again, a couple of unfortunate deaths. Like, he's still 7-4 and 10, right? You could just imagine if he hadn't made those couple of mistakes what we would be looking at for his score.
Yeah.
But it's been the saving grace a couple of times for LGD now, especially inside their own base, and now also outside the enemy base, that Silent just goes a little bit too far in.
Also, he's going to get even more aggressive with more damage. The Monkey King virus, the build for the Queen of Pain. Resolution still finding a lot of money himself, sitting just shy of 2,400. So his damage output starting to get a lot bigger in the fights, and it's actually not really that bad for Team Empire defending from high ground, because you got the splash damage coming out from the DK. If he gets high enough and he has the direct damage, then we're going to see these PL illusions not surviving that long. And Witch Doctor also has the Aghanim's upgrade.
That
so he's got a level 2
one.
Ulti on Witch Doctor, and LGD getting up and taking the ranks. That's when Empire can just take one big fight, keep a lot of their players alive, and then push back on LGD. They
and
probably
LGD
won't take a Rax in return, they'll just get buybacks.
They're just very limited in ways of dealing with the Rez Ward.
Too far up, they're gonna Hex on him. This DK way too far up, but maybe they have enough damage. Resolution's dropping low, and he's down for the count. The rest of Empire couldn't get there in time.
He does have buyback.
He does.
And he will have to use it, LGD will force it out. But what I was gonna say is, when it comes to Always Wanna Fly in this game, the number of counters to Witch Doctor currently are the Hex on Storm Spirit, his pull, and the two spells from Tusk. Snowball as well as Walrus Punch. The others cannot stuff it unless, like, low mana, mono leak into Blinding Light or something, but very unlikely, so. Those spells generally get used on the opener, so
jump in.
Get a good death.
Yoku going for the call, but Sylar's got a full heart. They've got to work through. Resolution might be back, but Sylar, he's tanking it all up. He'll doppelganger away, and now Swordsburst jumping in. The Death Ward's going to go to work, but only PL illusions remain. Sylar ensnared. They still need to chase out further here, Empire, but they've got a Hex and low heart death. No song on the side until Yoku makes space for the call. Neck charge as well. They get the malediction over on two for Resolution. He's completely out of mana. They're punching up on Yoku, but the Song of the Siren, they're trying to get Empire away. They will, under the cover of the sigil, maybe gets his BKB off. They jump in deeper, maybe dropping low. Where's the damage? Yoku back in again, but he's too low. The spins are doing some work, but it's just not enough. Yoku's down. They snowball in deep under the tier 4 towers. Not where Yao wants to be, but he blinks himself back to exactly where he wants to be. Outside the base, letting the PL illusion through the damage to the tower. They might get in there on Xiao Wei, but he's happy to stick around. Yoku bought back these PL illusions. Empire just have no mana to work with. They have no stamina in these fights. Well, the PL keeps draining them out, taking away these blink daggers. Silent again, forced to blink all the way back to well, while Sylar is this raid boss sitting on the front lines. He doppelgangers away as Yoku trying to jump him. Now Yoku's gonna go down. There's a big call. The damage, the Sonic Wave. They're just pushing him in. There was enough spins, but actually, no, there's not. There's just too much on Sylar. He is gonna win this game, hands down by himself. Silent, the only one. many things he can kill as the old man keeper of the line, a blink away down towards the mid lane, but they just keep getting healed up. Illuminate after Illuminate, bringing LGD back to 100%, and Silo once again moves forward to win it for LGD. He's doing it solo.
I disagree.
There's a lot of team behind him, but he could do it.
But you just saw, like, he has Butterfly Evasion and the Crest and Empire. They blew everything, and they got him to half.
Yep.
It's just not, that can't be the game plan for them until they get the MKBs. They just can't kill Siler. They have to try to go for the back line and play around that, because they're tanky themselves, but they don't output enough damage to deal with Siler. And yeah, this is, looks like it could be Megas. There's 40 seconds on Axe, who they definitely can't fight without. If nothing else, they will be taking the triple melees and then back out here as...
And LGD,
I don't think they're done.
They just take the full Megas. There is no reason to back up, always gonna fly, dead to the world. He got burned from the illusion to start with, and then Snowball over on 2, Silent being dragged back, Resolution as well, battling. They are farming Team Empire, practically on the edge of the well. There is only one remaining, and there it is, it's just GG. LGD take game one against Team Empire, repairing a 15k gold deficit to hit back with a very farmed up PL and a great game plan from LGD.
That has got to hurt Empire, though, because they were actually really, really close on two or three occasions to getting a lane of Rex and maybe just taking over the game and just ending the game.
Yeah.
Like 20 minutes ago, that was entirely possible, maybe even 25. And, well, when their lineup peaked, they had a couple of mistakes that were really costly. LGD played a very good defensive game. They are one of the absolute best teams, if not the best team, at playing high ground defense. They're extremely good at it, and they show again here that you simply cannot underestimate the threat of diving into their base. Okay, I just want to mention Siler has 38.3 fantasy points. That is very, very high. It's a fun fact. But
he had the greatest game ever, and Team Empire will have to go to the drafting board to find out how do they take LGD's base. That was the biggest hurdle in this game. Maybe we can get an answer from an analyst desk. We're going to head it back over to the boys.